So coming to the incidence, it usually affects every 5% in 10,000 population. And among the male and female, the males are most commonly affected when compared to the females. That means 80% of the adult males with the symptomatic ASR under the group of male persons. So if you see, aortic stenosis again, that divides into three types. One is valvular aortic stenosis, second one is subvalvular and supravalvular aortic stenosis. Subvalvular, supravalvular, we're not going to discuss here. These subvalvular, supravalvular are associated with some other abnormalities.
Very good, Peter.
Left leaf and pulmonary stenosis and other diseases, that is congenital disease. The valvular aortic stenosis again, it's mainly three types. The main underlying etiologies are three. One is congenital bicuspid aortic valve, rheumatic, and degenerative. If you see any patient or any patient presented with aortic stenosis, like if an infant or children or early adolescent presented with aortic stenosis, considered the most common underlying etiologies are subvalvular aortic stenosis or supravalvular aortic stenosis or a congenital bicuspid aortic valve. Suppose if a person presented with aortic stenosis in adolescent, adult, and up to middle age, the most common cause is the calcification of congenital also rheumatic etiology. And if a patient presented with AS between the ages of middle and elderly, the most common cause is degenerative or senile aortic stenosis, then rheumatic, followed by the calcification of congenital bicuspid valve. These are the presentation in various age group according to the underlying etiology. The same thing here, infants, children, and adolescents. Common causes of aortic stenosis are congenital aortic stenosis or congenital subvalvular or supravalvular associated with other diseases. In adults to middle age, mainly calcification or fibrosis of bicuspid aortic valve or a rheumatic etiology. Middle age to elderly, what we discussed, senile degeneration followed by the rheumatic and calcification of bicuspid aortic valves. So here again, there are some diagrams. The left upper one is the normal aortic wall, which contains three leaflets. Coming to the left upper one, there is two leaflets, that is a bicuspid aortic wall. And coming to the left lower down, here there is rheumatic etiology, fibrosis of the valve varifice, that leading to aortic stenosis. And coming to the right lower one, there is a senile degeneration of aortic valve. These are the common etiologies. Apart from the common etiologies, what are the other rare causes? The rare causes are mainly obstructive infective vegetations. Already discussed in mitral stenosis, maybe infective large vegetations or infective vegetations that may obstruct the blood flow from the left ventricle to the aorta. That is one thing. And second one, Paget's disease of the bone, where there is a hypercalcemia. That hypercalcemia leading to the deposition of calcium salts on the leaflets or valvulus, annulus. These two ones. And second one, SLE, that is systemic lupus erythematosus or rheumatoid arthritis. In these two conditions where there is a connective tissue fibrosis, a proliferation and fibrosis of the valve leaflets that produces aortic stenosis and the radiation, you know, that leading to fibrosis of the aortic valve leaflets. These are the some of the other causes, rare causes for the aortic stenosis. So most common causes are, one is congenital bicuspid aortic valve, second one is rheumatic AS, and third one is senile degeneration of the AS. If a patient presented with AS in child and adolescent, first common cause is congenital bicuspid aortic valve. If a patient presented with AS in late adulthood or middle age, most common cause is congenital bicuspid aortic valve calcification or fibrosis, and second one is rheumatic etiology. If a patient presented with AS in later age, first consider senile degeneration of aortic valve, followed by your rheumatic etiology and calcification or fibrosis of the congenital bicuspid valve. These are the underlying etiologies for the aortic stenosis. So coming to the senile degeneration, the most common risk factors for the aortic stenosis are metabolic syndrome, and obesity, hypertension, smoking, renal failure, hyperlipidemias, and male gender with oxidative stress, age. These are the common risk factors for the sclerosis of the aortic valve. The progressive sclerosis leading to the calcification of aortic valve leaflet that presented later aortic valve disease. So this is about the etiology of the aortic stenosis. So then coming to the pathophysiology of aortic stenosis. So if you see any stenosis, that means narrowing of the valve leaflet that obstructs the flow from upper chamber to the lower chamber. So like your mitral stenosis, what happened in mitral stenosis, the narrowing of the mitral valve leaflet at mitral orifice that leading to obstruction of blood flow from the left atrium to the left ventricle, that atrial hypertrophy. Like that, in aortic stenosis, there is a left ventricular obstruction that leading to decreased pumping of the blood from the left ventricle into the aorta or systemic circulation during the phase of ventricular systole. And so what happened, if there is a stenosis, left ventricle work hard or pump hard against the pressure gradient across the valve leaflet. That means there is increased left ventricular systolic pressure. That is the first change in the left ventricle. So what happened if the left ventricular systolic pressure is increased? That leading to hypertrophy of the left ventricular muscle mass. That means here, unlike your mitral regurgitation, also there is a chamber hypertrophy, but in mitral regurgitation, the eccentric hypertrophy of the left ventricle that leading to ventricular dilatation. But in case of aortic stenosis, here the hypertrophy is a concentric hypertrophy. The sarcolemmal fibers or sarcomere fibers are parallel to each other, that increases the thickness of ventricular myocardium rather than the chamber dilatation. So once what happened if the left ventricular muscle thickness is increased? So muscle thickness is increased, here the muscle consumption of oxygen by the muscle is increased, the first thing. Second one, there is some amount of contractile dysfunction that leading to ventricular diastolic dysfunction. So the first change in the aortic stenosis is left ventricular diastolic dysfunction rather than the systolic dysfunction. But till this level, there is a stroke volume is normal. After that, there is decreased stroke volume. So then, what is the other change whenever there is an outflow obstruction? The first change is left ventricular systolic pressure. So because of the pressure gradient in the left ventricle, pressure gradient between the left ventricle and aorta, the ventricular ejection time is increased. So whenever there is increased left ventricular ejection time, that leading to decreased diastolic filling. So decreased diastolic filling, that leading to decreased coronary circulation, decreased coronary circulation is there. Already there is an increased demand, decreased circulation, that leading to myocardial ischemia. That's the second change. Once the myocardial ischemia taken place, there is a ventricular contractile dysfunction. There is a chances of development of left ventricular systolic failure. This is the final stage of for late changes in the aortic stenosis, that is systolic dysfunction. So the second change is increased left ventricular ejection time. And at the same time, there is increased LV diastolic pressures because the amount of blood that is presented in the left ventricle is not completely ejected by the left ventricle. That leading to increased pressures in the left diastolic period. So that again, there is an increase in consumption of oxygen. But here there is a mismatch between the oxygen demand and supply that leading to myocardial ischemia. All these things leading to systolic dysfunction. So the earlier change in aortic stenosis is diastolic dysfunction, and the late change in aortic stenosis is systolic dysfunction. Okay. Then the same thing in a flowchart. Whenever there is aortic stenosis, there is a progressive decrease in area of aortic valve. The same thing what we discussed in the previous one, the early change is diastolic dysfunction, the late change is systolic dysfunction. Whenever there is a diastolic dysfunction, there is increased left ventricular diastolic pressures, consumption of oxygen is more, and there is a chance of myocardial ischemia, and there is a chances of atrial fibrillation. That's the two things. And whenever there is a systolic dysfunction, again, already told, this is myocardial ischemia, that leading to mitral regurgitation and systolic failure. That means whenever there is a left ventricular systolic dysfunction, the left ventricle unable to receive the blood from the left atrium to the left ventricle. That's first thing. And because of increased pressures in the left ventricle, it pumps the blood during the systole along the, through aortic wall, varices into the aorta. At the same time, because of the pressure, it pumps back into the left atrium. So there is a functional mitral regurgitation occurs in aortic stenosis. Late or end stage, there is a chances of development of pulmonary artery hypertension and right heart failure. This is about the aortic stenosis pathophysiology. Okay, the early changes are diastolic dysfunction. Late changes are systolic dysfunction. Diastolic dysfunction is because of left ventricular muscle mass or concentric hypertrophy. Systolic dysfunction is mainly due to myocardial ischemia, myocardial fibrosis. Okay, then. What are the clinical features of aortic stenosis? The classical triad of aortic stenosis are exertional dyspnea, angina, and exertional syncope. So usually mild to moderate AS, they doesn't present with its symptoms, usually asymptomatic patients. And triad is exertional dyspnea and angina and exertional syncope. The exertional dyspnea means patient has breathlessness whenever there is a exertional works initially during the phase of diastolic dysfunction, but without any exertional work, later on patient develops dyspnea, that is progressive left ventricular dilatation and systolic dysfunction. So exertional mainly because of LVH and breathlessness or orthopnea because of the systolic dysfunction. And second one, angina. Angina episodes is mainly due to decreased coronary circulation because of the one thing, decreased diastolic time. And second one, ventricular myocardium, that increases the myocardial oxygen consumption. That means there is a mismatch between the demand and supply because of the muscle mass and because of the decreased flow that leads into anginal episodes. That's the second symptom. And sometimes in patients with later on associated coronary artery disease is again risk factor for the development of angina in patients with AS. So coming to the syncope, the excessional, why there is excessional syncope? In late stages of cardiac AS, there is a fixed cardiac output where there is a severe AS. Any work that induces vasodilatation, like your exercise or any drugs like calcium channel blockers or any vasodilation stimulation, that these vasodilatation that requires more amount of blood or it augments the cardiac output, that leading to drop in the cerebral perfusion pressures that produces your exertional syncope. That means decreased cerebral perfusion during the exercises or during vagal stimulation or any drugs or fixed cardiac output status, some exertional work leading to a syncope. That's first cause. And second cause, in case of SNI, there is a calcium deposition in the aortic ring that encroaches the conductive tissue, may induce your conduction blocks that leading to your exertional syncope, the second one. And the third cause for exertional syncope in AS is ventricular hypertrophy or myocardial infarction. It induces ventricular arrhythmias. Ventricular arrhythmias is again a cause for exertional syncope. Then sometimes patient may present with sudden cardiac death because of the ventricular arrhythmias or bundle branch blocks. So the cardinal symptoms of aortic stenosis, one is exertional dyspnea due to diastolic dysfunction, and later it is due to the systolic dysfunction, angina because of the mismatch between supply and demand, exertional syncope, fixed cardiac outputs that leading to decreased cerebral perfusion, or maybe it is a heart block or arrhythmia that induces your syncope, and the other is sudden cardiac. Apart from these four symptoms, the late features of aortic stenosis, maybe there is a mitral regurgitation, functional mitral regurgitation. That functional mitral regurgitation leading to orthopnea, PMD, and sometimes patient may present with active pulmonary edema. Okay, so if a patient, usually we already discussed in the last class, single valvular diseases are uncommon, maybe rheumatic, mostly a multivalvular diseases or multiple regions at a single valve are more common in rheumatic. Whenever there is a patient presented with a coexistent of MS, there is a reduction in cardiac output that leading to decrease the symptoms or maybe mask the symptoms of aortic stenosis. Keep in mind while examining the patient with AS and MS. So after the clinical symptomatology, coming to the signs usually the pulse is pulse. Usually the pulse is very low volume, that is very small or a weak pulse, which rises very slowly. This is called parvus et artus. So arterial pulse is pulsus parvus et artus, the low volume or a weak pulse which rises very slowly. It is best appreciated in carotid artery, that's the central arteries. So whenever you put the fingers over the carotid artery where the pulse is palpable in a reduced amplitude and there is a delayed peak occurrence. So that is called pulsus parvus et artus. And sometimes you may be this associated with carotid artery thrill or a coarse vibration, that is called shuddering. These shuddering usually due to marked turbulence across the stenotic valve that produces a vibrations over the carotid artery. Okay, so carotid thrill or pulsus parvus et artus is common examination findings. Coming to the blood pressure usually it is a stenotic blood pressure. Stenotic means a narrow pulse pressure. That is, the difference between the systolic pulse pressure to the diastolic is less than 30. It is called stenotic blood pressure. Usually, it is seen in AS and also MS. Okay, coming to the palpation. Palpation. You have to palpate the cardiac apex. Apex doesn't shift anywhere, is the normal position, and the apical impulse is sustained lift, that means heaving apical impulse, unless up to the development of systolic failure. Once the systolic failure is developed, the apical impulse is shifted outwards and downwards, but it is very late finding. Then second finding in palpation is systolic thrill. A systolic thrill is usually felt in the right second, that is articaria, second back intercostal space. A patient is in sitting and leaning forward position. The systolic thrill is due, if thrill is present, it is due to valvular disease. Then coming to the auscultation. Auscultation already discussed in mitral regurgitation. First you have to comment on heart sounds. Then you have to comment on additional heart sounds, followed by the additional sounds, and then murmur. So auscultation, so first heart sound is normal because first heart sound is produced by the mitral and tricuspid valves. So second heart sound usually due to the closure of aortic valve and the pulmonary valve. So here the second heart sound is soft and single sound. That means A2, usually there is two components in second heart sound, that is A2 component and P2 component. A2 component is due to the aortic valve closure and P2 component is due to the pulmonary valve closure. But A2 closes early compared to the P2 because of there is a interval between the A2 and P2. That is the handover interval. We'll discuss in pulmonary artery hypertension session. Okay, then here the A2 is delayed because of the pressure gradients across the left ventricle and aorta that comes closest to the P2. These two are heard as a single sound. There is no second sound. So A2 may be a single because of the pressure gradients across the left ventricle and aorta that leading to delayed closure of the A2. Sometimes, that is one finding. Sometimes there is absent A2 is not audible, only P2 is audible because of the calcification or maybe immobility of the aortic valve leaflet or the severe or fixed AS. That is, valve area is less than 1 cm is called severe and fixed AS is a critical AS or immobile calcified leaflets that produces absent A2. Sometimes there is a paradoxical split. So paradoxical split means P2 closes early rather than the A2. That means again it shows the severity of the aortic stenosis where there is increasing pressures, that is one thing, and second one, in case of left bundle branch block associated with aortic stenosis, that leading to paradoxical split of the second sound. So these are the two sounds. So second heart sound, this one is normal, and second heart sound usually it's a soft and single. And why? Because of single means delayed closure of A2 and it comes near to the P2, that heard as a single one. Or sometimes the A2 is absent because of the calcified or fixed leaflets. And sometimes there is a paradoxical split because of the delayed closure of A2 after the P2. That is one thing. So apart from S1, S2, the other sound heard is the fourth heart sound. This fourth heart sound, usually due to vigorous contractions of the left atrium, that produces the fourth heart sound because of the mitral. So heart sounds audible in aortic stenosis is S1, S2 and S4. It's not S3. S3 is usually due to ventricular diastolic dysfunction or ventricular contracting effect. Okay, it's seen in the left ventricular dysfunction, not in the this one. Okay. Then coming to the other sounds. Other sounds, usually there is an ejection click in aortic area, that is aortic ejection click. Aortic ejection click usually heard in where there is a congenital bicuspid valve. So it's heard in the systolic phase because of severe or stiffened congenital leaflets, but there is some amount of mobility or complaints of the leaflets. But there is some amount of mobility is there that produces a clicking sound during the phase of ventricular systole that gives a ejection click in the aortic area. Okay, so the additional sounds are aortic ejection click, usually seen in congenital bicuspid aortic valves. Then coming to the murmurs, so heart sounds, additional sounds followed by the murmur in aortic area, usually it's a ejection systolic murmur. The description of ejection systolic murmur is a crescendo decrescendo ejection systolic murmur, which is harsh in quality or a grating quality. It's hard, best in the aortic area with a diaphragm of the stent and right second intercostal space. Patient is sitting and leaning forward and breath held in expiration, and it is a diffuse murmur and it radiates to both carotid arteries and at same time to the mitral area. So this is a classical description of the aortic stenosis murmur. Whenever there is a more severe stenosis, like moderate severe or critical, if moderate to severe stenosis, the duration of murmur is increases, but the peaking, that is crescendo means upward phase, descending phase is called decrescendo phase. The peaking is occurs in late systolic, that is, that shows there is a severity of the disease. Okay, then apart from this, in case of elderly persons with calcific AS, the murmur may be more prominent at the apex rather than the aortic valve. If the murmur is more prominent in aortic valve, probably suspect a valvular disease. If the murmur is more prominent in mitral area, you suspect a calcific AS or senile AS. Because of the radiation of high frequency components of ejection systolic murmur, you may hear a soft blowing murmur at the apex. This is called Gallivadia phenomenon. So that means Gallivadia phenomena means there is changing of the murmur quality and intensity or nature from one place to other place. Usually in case of aortic stenosis, you may hear ejection systolic murmur in the aortic area. At the same time, you may hear pansystolic murmur in the mitral area. Okay, and here it's a harsh quality or a grating quality. Coming to the mitral area, it is so there is a changing in nature and changing in quality or timing, that is called Gallivadia phenomena. How you appreciate the Gallivadia phenomena? This is by inch by inch auscultation. You put your step over the second right space or aortic area, then pulmonary area. Coming from pulmonary area, little down left parastolically up to tricuspid area, from tricuspid area towards the mitral area. You can notice the changing of the quality and changing of the nature of the murmur. So inch by inch auscultation is the one which explains the Gallivadia phenomena. That's one thing. Then, so this pansystolic murmur in the mitral area, you can misinterpret as an MR. Already in MR session, we discussed regarding the differential diagnosis of pansystolic murmur in the mitral area. After the differential diagnosis, go back to the MR. One is mitral regurgitation, second one is tricuspid regurgitation, third one is VSD, and fourth one is AS. In the mitral regurgitation class, we discuss in detail how to differentiate between each murmur, MR, TR, VSD, and AS, depending upon the various qualities like site of production, intensity, radiation, other maneuvers. Okay, I'm not going to those things now. Okay, so then critical AS, or if the valve area is very much narrow, the murmur may become very softer and shorter, like your mitral stenosis. If mitral stenosis is very severe, the murmur is very soft and loud intensity of the first heart sound may be masked. Like that, in critical AS, the murmur become more soft and shorter. So these are the findings in auscultation. So auscultation, what are the findings observed? S1 is absolutely normal. The second sound is a single second sound, or maybe absent second sound, or maybe a paradoxical split you can hear. And the fourth sound is, you may heard the fourth heart sound, and second additional sounds like ejection, systolic ejection click may be heard in the aortic area, followed by your murmur. Murmur is ejection, systolic murmur, I described already, heard in the aortic area, which may be radiate to the mitral area. Okay, so then coming to the ventricles. So look at down, there are some lines are there, the S1, S2. So here in S2, there are two components, the red one is aortic component and the blue one is the pulmonary components. What happened in a mild? Mild, there are no changes in S1, A2 and A2. Coming to the moderate, the intensity, there is a paradoxical state, that is, pulmonary is closer cellular compared to the aortic. In case of severe, there is absence of the, or very minimal A2 compared to the P2. This is the intensity or severity of the aortic stenosis. So coming to this one, this chart shows the differences between mild, moderate and severe aortic stenosis depending on the physical findings. If you take a mild one, the carotid pulse is normal. In case of moderate, there is a slow rising. In case of severe, there is a pulsus parvus rectangulus. Okay. And coming to the LV apical impulse, LV apex is within the normal position in case of mild without any heaving. In case of moderate, there is a heaving quality of the apical impulse. And in case of severe, there is a heaving, sustained lift, and sometimes may be displaced. And the auscultation, already discussed, S2 is normal in case of mild, moderate, normal or a single sound may be heard. In severe, single or a paradoxical split may be audible on auscultation. And there is S4 is present in moderate to severe. It's not audible in mild cases. And then systolic ejection click may be heard in mild, moderate, but underlying, depending upon the underlying etiology, mostly in congenital bicuspid valves. And the murmur is systolic ejection, systolic murmur. The peaking of the murmur is seen early systole in case of mild AS, and mid systole in case of moderate AS, and very delayed peaking or late systolic is seen in severe AS. These are the differences between mild, moderate, severe, depending on the examination findings. Then, what are the differential diagnosis for AS? The differential diagnosis for AS mainly aortic stenosis, HOC, hypertrophic obstructive cardiomyopathy, and mitral valve prolapse, mainly the prolapse that is due to posterior wall leaflet. These are the three differential diagnoses for the AS. So you see the left one, it's a normal interventricular septum. You see, observe the right side, there is a hypertrophy of the interventricular septum that leading to partial obstruction of the aortic valve area, that is subvalvular apparatus, subvalvular area that may mimic AS, but it is not a AS. Okay. So all these things not necessary, how to differentiate between MVP, hypertrophic cardiomyopathy and AS, depending upon the maneuvers, this is not discussed now. Then coming to the diagnosis. So you know, clinical features, the mainly clinical features are symptoms, exertional dyspnea, exertional syncope, and angina may be sometimes presented with sudden cardiac death. Later features, because of the left ventricular systolic dysfunction, patient may present with orthopnea, PNV, or even left ventricular failures. And sometimes examination signs mainly, one is pulsus parvus rectatus and narrow pulse pressure. And auscultation, a palpation, there is a sustained heaving apical impulse which may not displace when early phases, but later on it displaces whenever there is left ventricular systolic failure. And there is a systolic failure, and there is a palpable thrill in the aortic area. And an auscultation, S1 is normal, S2 we discussed already, there is S4, presence of S4, and there is ejection click in aortic area and ejection systolic murmur in the aortic area. These are the examination findings. Then coming to the diagnosis, how do you diagnose the patient with the AS? One is depending on clinical history and findings, you may diagnose the disease. But supportive evidence, usually for any cardiac disease, you need chest X-ray, you need ECG and 2D echo. Chest X-ray, it may be normal in early stages because the early change is only diastolic dysfunction without any change. But whenever there is a left ventricular hypertrophy, that is a late stage, that leading to hypertrophy of the left ventricular dilatation of the chamber. And because of the pressure gradients, there is sometimes dilatation of the ascending aorta, you may observe in the chest X-ray. And whenever there is a calcification of aortic leaflets in case of senile or some other diseases, you may observe in the chest X-ray. You see here on the left side, there is a calcification or dilatation of the aortic ascending aorta. And in the right diagram, you may observe the calcification of the aortic valve. And here you see the ascending aorta dilatation. So here it's more visible. Here this is the ascending aortic dilatation, and here it is the descending aortic valve dilatation, and also here there are the calcifications in the descending aorta. Here the same one. So coming to the ECG. ECG, usually we discuss ventricular hypertrophy. What's the main change? Change is ventricular hypertrophy. How to diagnose left ventricular hypertrophy on ECG? Already we discussed in mitral regurgitation. So the one, the depth of PS complexes in V1 plus the height of R wave in V6 is more than 35 millimeters, that indicates there is a left ventricular hypertrophy. Or if you take any single lead, if it is more than 25 mm, that again shows there is a left ventricular hypertrophy. The one is left ventricular hypertrophy, and the second one is left bundle branch block. Already we discussed why there is a left bundle branch block. There is encroachment of calcifications over the bundle that produces a left bundle branch block. And the left bundle branch block on ECG, there is a wide PS complexes, that is more than 3 mm. That leads to, that shows there is a left bundle branch block. And because of ventricular muscle thickness, there is a strain pattern you can observe in the ECG. The strain pattern, like there is a sloping of ST segment, sometimes maybe a T-wave inversions, all these are visible in ECG. So coming to this ECG, you see here, the depth of PS complex in V1 and the plus height of PS R wave in the V6, it's more than 35. Here, if you take in V6 only, here there is 30 mm. So it's an LVH. And already I told that the strain pattern in the form of ST segment sloping and T wave inversion, which shows the strain pattern of the left ventricle. These are the two findings observed in the ECG. And the third one, already told, there is a more than 3 mm, that 120
millimeters.
During the
hold number 186 came and please
change sari march edi correct ga change
So coming to the echo, so what is the use of 2D echo in diagnosis of valvular disease? One thing, you may measure the valve area. Depending upon the valve area, you assess the severity of the underlying aortic stenosis. And second one, you can note valve leaflets like aortic valve is a tricuspid. If is there any congenital bicuspid valve, you may detect. Or is there any calcifications over the valve leaflet or periannular area, you can seen in the echo, and is there any thickness of valve? You may seen in the 2D echo. So this is the importance of 2D echo, and at the same time, you can assess the pressure gradients between the left ventricle and the aorta. Okay, or maybe associated coexisting lesions you can observe. So, what is the importance of echo? One is, depending upon the valve area, you can assess the severity. So what is the normal valve area of aortic valve? That is 3 to 4 cm². Okay. But in case of usually up to 2 cm, they doesn't produce any clinical symptoms. So mild AS means 1.5 cm to 2 cm. Moderate AS means the wall weight is between 1 centimeter to 1.5 centimeter. Severe means it is less than 1 centimeter. And critical means it is less than 0.7 centimeter square. This is the, depending upon the valve area, you can grade the severity of the AS. That is one thing you can see in the echo. And second one, you can see the valvular calcifications over the cusp or over the annulus or underneath that cusp, or is there any ventricular myocardial hypertrophy, or is there any ventricular septum thickening? You can assess with the help of the pressure gradient across the left ventricle and aortic wall. Okay, these are the use. This is the use of 2D echo in diagnosing AS. So in the left one, you can see here. You see there is a calcification of the aortic wall leaflet that leading to a narrowing of the aortic wall leaflet. Okay, and here you see. So you see, this is the aortic wall. Here there is a membrane underneath that. That is subvalvular endocardial cushion defects that produces even subvalvular AS. You see here, this is the subvalvular apparatus. There there is a thickening of the membrane, the cardial membrane. So these are the, some echo findings in AS. So coming to the, depending upon the echo criteria, how do you assess the severity of AS? Severity of AS, already I told, depending, one is depending upon the valve area, and second one is depending upon the pressure gradient across the valve. So coming to the mild, mild means it is more than 1.5 to 2, and the pressure gradient across the valve, if it is less than 25 millimeter of mercury, it is called mild. Moderate, the area is between 1 to 1.5 centimeter square, but the pressure gradient is somewhat high, that is 25 to 50 millimeter of mercury. Severe means less than 1 centimeter, that is usually 0.7 to 1 centimeter, but the pressure gradient across the valve is increases little bit higher, it is 50 to 80 millimeter of mercury. Critical means the valve area is narrow, that is less than 0.7 centimeter square, and the pressure gradient across the valve leaflet is more than 80 millimeters. So if there is an increase in severity, decrease in the valve area, and increase in the pressure gradient across the valve leaflets. Okay, then what are the complications? After the diagnosis, what are the complications? So the diagnosis of AS is mainly depending upon the clinical history and examination findings, supportive evidence by your chest X-ray, ECG, and 2D echo. Okay, and 2D echo, we can assess the severity of the disease for management protocols or treatment options. Then after that, the complications. So complications of aortic wall, mainly, already I told, later stages of aortic stenosis that produces systolic dysfunction, that is congestive heart failure. And sometimes may present a sudden cardiac death because of ventricular arrhythmias or bundle branch blocks or wound dissociations. And third one, atrial arrhythmias because of the left atrial dilatation, that's one thing. And in fact, endocarditis chances are minimal, but it is one of the complications of aortic stenosis. And systemic calcium embolization because of the calcium depositions over the valve leaflet and periannular area in case of some metabolic diseases. These are some complications of aortic stenosis, but we discuss later one by one. Then what are the treatment options for AS? The treatment, you know, underlying etiology, and you know what are the pathophysiological changes in AS. But then depending upon that, we have to approach, treat the patient. One is avoid strenuous exercise, because exercises that induces additional syncope or maybe arrhythmias, maybe it leading to sudden cardiac death. So we avoid strenuous exercises. Advise the patient to avoid strenuous exercise is the one thing. And second one, avoid hypotension, because already there is a narrowed pulse pressure. So if there is a hypotension, again it aggravates. So it again decreases the cardiac output, again induces the myocardial ischemia or syncope or other things. So you avoid hypertension or avoid dehydration to protect from the decreased cardiac output. That's one thing you have to look after. Then treat the hypertension, coronary artery disease, because hypertension is again produces even aortic stenosis. If there is the hypertension, avoid calcium channel blockers, because calcium channel blockers that induces vasodilatation in patients. So avoid calcium channel blockers. We treat with beta blockers and ACE inhibitors in case of AS. And coronary artery disease, depending upon the because there is already, you know, left ventricular muscle mass is increased, there is demand mismatch between the demand and supply that produces either myocardial ischemia or infarction sometimes. So you treat the coronary artery disease in the patient. And then
Hi Sirisha, kindly leave the audio.
So for any, like any other valvular diseases, go with endocarditis prophylaxis or rheumatic fever prophylaxis if patient is present with it. Already I discussed in the mitral regurgitation regarding endocarditis prophylaxis and rheumatic fever prophylaxis. Okay, these are treatment options. Then the major surgical removal or surgical replacement of aortic wall is the major one is used in the aortic stenosis. So indications for my aortic wall replacement are mainly severe aortic stenosis. That's one thing. That is, wall area is less than 1 centimeter or less than 0.7 centimeter. That's one thing. LV dysfunction, that is systolic dysfunction, starts, so that is less than 50%, because if there is a severe systolic dysfunction in case of AS, it's again contraindication for the valve replacement. So if LV dysfunction starts, that is EF is less than 50%, this is the indication for aortic valve replacement. Then any aneurysmal dilatation of aortic valve, already told, because of the pressure gradients, pooling of the blood in the aortic root, that leading to root dilatation. So any expansion of the root more than 4.5 centimeters or increasing size more than 0.5 centimeters per year, it is one of the indication for aortic wall replacement. Then, asymptomatic patients with moderate to severe AS, but who undergo CABG or aortic root reconstruction, is again there is an indication for aortic wall replacement. These are the indications for the aortic wall replacement. But the timing, what's the timing of aortic wall? Before development of systolic failure, already I told, before systolic failure development, that's the best time for the replacement of aortic wall. That means EF is around 50%. Patient with failure, there is 15 to 20% of mortality in LV dysfunction. Okay, that's one thing. Age, there is no age limit or there is no age bar. Any age, you can reconstruct the aortic valve replacement. And mortality, maybe a 3% mortality with aortic valve replacement. The survival rate is little better compared with the other valve replacement. It is 60% 10-year survival rate is there. And valve failure, mostly observed in bioprosthetic valves, around 30% in 10 years. This is about the aortic valve replacement timing and prognosis. Then, you see, there are two types of valves, already told, bioprosthetic valves or metallic valves. So, what is the difference between the mechanical valves and the bioprosthetic? Mechanical valves, the durability is more, what already discussed in mitral regurgitation, that is some refinement of the things. Mechanical, the durability is more, but bioprosthetic, there is not durable. And mechanical for larger orifices, bioprosthetic for smaller orifices, or maybe a functional stenosis. But the rate of higher thromboembolic potentials in mechanical valves observed, but low thromboembolic potentials in bioprosthetic valves. And mechanical best is used in left side, bioprosthetic usually in the right. And most commonly, young patients advise mechanical, and elderly patients you may advise bioprosthetic valve. In case of mechanical, there is a chronic warfarin therapy is required, but bioprosthetic, there is no need for the chronic warfarin. These are the differences between mechanical and bioprosthetic valve. Maybe it is a short notes for you in exams. Differences between mechanical valve and bioprosthetic valves. Then, what are the prognostic factors or predictors of poor outcome in AS? If a patient is age of more than 70 years, again, there is a poor outcome. If a female gender, usually I told, there is a males are more commonly affected with AS than female. The female gender, again, it's a poor outcome or poor predictor. And emergency surgeries, like patient is presented with sudden onset of severe breathlessness or aortic root dilatation or something, So there's again emergency surgery is a good outcome, and coronary mixed with coronary artery diseases or a previous history of coronary artery grafting, these are again poor predictors for the VAs. And hypertension, left ventricular dysfunction, that is ejection fraction is less than 45%, again there is a poor predictors. And heart failure, AF, it's combined with other valve replacements like mitral valve repair or replacement, the chances of poor outcome. And renal failure again, there is a poor outcome. So these are the predictors of the poor outcome in AAs after the surgery. So advancing age, female gender, emergency surgery combined with coronary artery disease or a previous AVG, or patient with pre-existing factors like hypertension, heart failure, atrial fibrillation, or associated with concomitant mitral valve replacement or repair, all are the poor outcome of the surgical procedures. This is about the AS. Okay. So we'll go with 2 minutes review. This 1 hour, this 50 minutes we discussed regarding one is what is aortic stenosis, definition of aortic stenosis, what are the different types of aortic stenosis, what are the underlying etiologies for the AS aortic stenosis, then what is the pathophysiology of the aortic stenosis, clinical features and symptoms and signs of aortic stenosis, followed by diagnosis, how do you diagnose depending upon the chest X-ray, ECG and 2D echo, the findings, and how to assess the severity of the AS depending upon the echo findings. Then treatment options mainly medical and surgical. What is the importance of surgical? And then timing, what are the different devices available and what are the outcome of the surgery, we discussed in this class. Okay, we'll discuss next class regarding other valvular disease at the same wall like aortic regurgitation. Okay, thank you.